Heather thinks about software.
Recently, a story appeared in an online publication called Fast Company about Adobe offering protection against copyright infringement if you use their AI drawing tools. Why was this such interesting news? It seems like everyone is talking about AI these days. Some people think AI is going to destroy the world, and some think it will save the world. But there's a different question about AI. To add the alarmist flavor necessary to grab eyeballs and ears today, the question is,
will AI destroy copyright?
Now, copyright has been around for hundreds of years. It's a government-granted monopoly on a thing called a work of authorship, such as a book, video, music, or even software source code. AI has been around for decades, but what's new is generative AI, which produces the kind of output that could be protected by copyright. And more importantly, to create generative AI models, you need to train them on human-created works of authorship. Today, people are saying that generative AI models like ChatGPT for text, Copilot for software, or Stable Diffusion for artwork are collage tools for infringing mashups of copyrightable works. That's the phrase used in a recent class action lawsuit anyway. And as we all know, class action lawyers are experts on computer technology. But lots of copyright experts disagree, and here's why. When machine learning models are trained, they are usually trained on millions of data inputs. In other words, if you want a model to create a drawing, you train it on millions of drawings so that it learns how to make a drawing. Copyright doesn't prohibit all copying, just making infringing copies. Copyright doesn't protect fair use, functional elements, trite and common expression, which is called semaphore, or short words and phrases. And here's the important point. If you train a model correctly, on enough data and with the right parameters, it ought to produce generic output, not simply reproduce its inputs. That would probably mean the model is non-infringing. But it would be easy to train a model to infringe. I asked a chatbot, what is Ogden Nash's favorite poem? And I got this. The cow is of the bovine ilk. One end is moo, the other milk. That answer reproduced the entire poem. That would, at least on face, be infringing. Of course, the above is fair use because this is a commentary. But when people talk about machine learning models producing infringing content, that's not really what they mean. They mean that if you give the model a generic prompt, it should produce a non-infringing work. Japan and Israel have passed specific laws about this issue to protect machine learning developers. But in the US, we only have a bunch of old dusty case law to go on, and our government is busy with larger issues, so we'll probably be fighting about it in the courts for years to come. That brings us to what was so interesting about Adobe's announcement. If you look at the terms and conditions in contracts to use the latest AI tools, other vendors of generative AI tools have been trying very hard to limit or avoid their liability in their contracts if their tools produce infringing output. But Adobe stepped up to the plate. Why is that different? Is Adobe just more generous to its customers? No. Model developers have taken various approaches to sanitizing their selection of training data to avoid this infringement problem. Some have only used works licensed under open source or Creative Commons licenses, which expressly grant the necessary rights. Some have just taken the position that training is fair use and requires no license. But Adobe is in a unique position. It says Firefly has been trained primarily from Adobe's own image libraries. The Firefly website FAQ says, as part of Adobe's effort to address generative AI-related copyright infringement concerns, we are training our initial Firefly model on Adobe stock images, openly licensed content, and public domain content where copyright has expired. Now we're getting to the crux of the matter. Adobe owns rights to a lot of images. Other developers might rely on outside data, mostly scraped from the internet. But this tells you a lot about who can develop generative AI these days with the least risk. It's all about data access, not to mention compute cycles. As it stands today, AI is data intensive and compute intensive to train. So the players are most likely those who have early access to tons of input data, like GitHub for software or Adobe for images, or those who have access to tons of compute cycles, like OpenAI, which is backed up by a sweetheart deal with Microsoft to provide access to its cloud computing services. On its website, Adobe says, "Adobe is committed to developing generative AI responsibly with creators at the center. As Firefly evolves, we will continue to work closely with the creative community to build technology that supports and improves the creative process." Embedded in that statement is the crux of the issue. According to the law, copyright is supposed to maximize creative outputs, not just protect authors. How to set the balance between the rights of authors who have created works in the past and those who are creating them in the moment is a question that will always be with us. Generative AI is a new craze, but this is an old tension. Thanks for listening. Liking and subscribing makes me think more.
Heather thinks about software.